Hi, I'm Pastor Mark Rose from Christ Lutheran here in Brenham, Texas, and we're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us today. We know that worship is important, both as a mark of discipleship and as a source to grow faith within us. We also know that there are times and when circumstances don't allow us to be physically present for the gathering. But through the gift of technology and a worshipful heart, you will be present in the gathering today. At Christ Lutheran, we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion at every worship service. But for this abbreviated recording, the service will conclude following the message. So if you'd like to be present for the sacrament, we invite you to gather with us in person or our live stream at 9:15 on Sundays or for Wednesday church at 6:30. So now, please take a moment and prepare your hearts and your minds for worship. And welcome to Christ Lutheran, where everyone fits. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace for the whole world and for the well-being of the Church of God and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious God. We gather this morning in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God receives our joys and concerns, we offer our prayers for the church, for those in need, and all of creation. Please pray with me. God of the covenant, you call ministers to proclaim your gospel of grace throughout the world. Inspire pastors and deacons, church musicians, and all ministers of your word as they carry out your work. Lord, in your mercy, God of all creation, you reveal your goodness through all that you have made. Rivers and seas, plants and animals, endangered species. Encourage and bless the work of those who advocate and care for creation. Lord, in your mercy, God of nations, you desire that all people in the world live in peace. Guide government leaders throughout the world to work for justice and mercy and reconciliation. We pray for our president and all elected leaders, for those who respond to our crisis, fight our fires, keep us safe, and those who work for peace. Lord, in your mercy, God of compassion, you bring healing to those who are sick, consolation to those who are grieving, and well-being to those who are distraught. Provide those in need with skilled caregivers, and make your presence known among all who suffer in mind, body, and spirit. Oh Lord, you know our concerns even before we offer them. And yet we do so as an embrace of our faith as we name our concerns at this time. Lord, in your mercy, God of rejoicing, you have brought us together this day to worship around word and sacrament. Give us patience to wait on you as we make our way through the changes and chances of this life. And give us the faith to trust your promises of new life, now and forever. Lord, in your mercy, O God of all faithfulness, through the witness of the faithful departed, instill in us the desire to be your church in this place. Show us where you would have us go and what you would have us do. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation unto himself, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And all of God's people said, Amen. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our risen Lord Jesus Christ. Please pray with me one more time. O God, come to us now by your Spirit, inspire us, open us up to your will for us. Remove those things that stand in the way. We ask you to bless these words read and offered that they might be acceptable in your hearing and grow faith in those who seek you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I was mentioning something about knocking on doors, and that has something to do with starting a church. Starting a new congregation, a new church, is not an easy task, though statistically today it seems that it's a little easier than sustaining an older congregation, but that's for another time. Before Debbie and I came to Brenham, I was a church planter, or what our denomination calls a mission developer, in Western Iowa. It wasn't something that I ever thought I would do or be. When I was in seminary, it never came across my mind that I would be someone who would start a church. And it just sort of happened organically. And the process for starting a congregation at that time was much different than it was when this congregation was formed. In 2008, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, our denomination, approached me and asked me to be interviewed to see if I had any the particular gifts that are needed to start a congregation. And apparently they determined after this interview that I did, and then they sent me to Chicago for a course for a few days. And then Debbie and I went off to a place called Sergeant Bluff, Iowa, which is a bedroom community. It's really just right up against Sioux City. Both have grown together. They gave me a $48,000 grant to add to a meager budget that I put together. And somewhere along the way, I acquired a copy machine. And along with 13 people from primarily two families, they told me to start a church. And so we rented some space from a Methodist congregation that worshiped at 10:30 on Sunday mornings, so we worshiped at 9 a.m. Actually, everybody showed up at 9:03. And then after worship, we would gather for a time of Bible study and fellowship. And then I started going to meetings in the community of civic organizations and other things just to be known. And then I started to knock on doors. Lots of doors. Now, I should tell you that the return on knocking on doors isn't that great. They say it's about 1%. So if you knock on 100 doors, you might get one person who's interested enough to come and visit you. In the summertime, we would have an entry or a float in every parade in our area. I mean, you got to remember this is northwestern Iowa, so there's only so much time of the year that you can walk around outside without wearing a coat. And so we were in every parade. We put together a small band of high school kids led by one adult that would ride on the float and play music. And then we would walk alongside the float and hand out bottled water that had our own label on it. And along with the label, there was information about this new community, New Life Lutheran Church. And like I said, when we started, we had 13 people. And about 4.5 years later, when I came to Brenham, we had about 120 members, and we worshiped anywhere from 65 to 75 regularly. Not only that, we did lots of mission. The process now is different, thank God. We've kind of gone back to the time when congregations start congregations. That seems to work a lot better. But I have to tell you that starting a church in this way, well, it was hard work. And it was, at times, it felt risky and uncertain and emotionally exhausting. But it was also a time of great and exciting reward. It felt good to start something new and to see these people get excited about being a part of something new. That said, can you imagine if I were to show up or come into your midst today and tell you that everything that you knew about your faith, your lifelong faith, well, it was no longer the whole story. That, in fact, the anointed one that you had been waiting for, the one that you had been claiming, has now come. And as a result, you were living in the kingdom that you had been waiting for or hoping for, something like that. How would that sound to you? Well, that's where we find the book of Acts. Jesus ascends into the sky, the scripture says, and leaves these disciples, these apostles, to the task of sharing the good news that the kingdom of God has come near. But he assures them that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, the Paraclete, the Helper, or the Christ, would not only come in their midst, but would enter into them through faith in him, and that with his help, they would teach others that to love God was to care for the widow and the orphan and the stranger, to care for the poor and the poor in spirit, because that's the way it is in God's kingdom. They are to share that because of Jesus' death when he was nailed to the cross, their broken relationship with God had been restored, but they no longer had to be good enough to know God's love, that God loved them just the way that they were. And that in his resurrection, they would discover that they have become a new creation, that they were to spread this good news to the ends of the earth. In other words, this what we find in the book of Acts is the beginning of Christ's church, which they were to start through faith in him. But at first, they weren't starting something necessarily new, at least not at first. They still, these disciples and apostles still went to the synagogues. They still went to their church. They still practiced Judaism. They were just adding Jesus into the mix to explain that he was the Christ, the anointed one that they had been waiting for. Well, you can imagine how that might have been received. Well, that's what the book of Acts, written by Luke, is all about. And we're going to begin our series for the next few weeks and look at how they overcame the obstacles to plant or develop his church on a solid rock of faith, and then share that faith with others so that the message of Jesus would spread throughout the world and that the church would grow. I mean, when you look at it that way, a copy machine and knocking on a few doors doesn't seem all that big of a deal. So if we look and read the book of Acts, we'll see how these apostles kind of stumbled through their way into starting a church that still exists 2,000 years later. And though some things may not apply to us culturally, there is an insight there that can help us as we continue to be Christ's church in this place. Now, just so you're aware, for the sake of time, I'm not going to go through the book of Acts line by line. This isn't a Bible study, but instead I would like to consider some of the themes or important points or moments from different parts of the Acts of the Apostles. So we're going to start at the beginning. This is Acts 1. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over the course of 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. This is the word of the Lord. Now, the gospel writer Luke was an apostle who was considered the author of the third gospel, which bears his name, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, right? He's also the author of the Acts of the Apostles, or as we would say, the book of Acts, which immediately follows the fourth gospel of John. So some call the book of Acts actually the fifth gospel, but I'll leave that to you to struggle with. Now, we know that Luke was not one of the original 12 disciples that we read about all of time, but he was probably one of the 70 that Jesus sent out that we can read about in Luke chapter 10. It is widely believed that he was also a companion or a disciple, if you will, of the Apostle Paul, and we'll get to him a little later on. Chapter 1, what I just read to you, begins with the writer Luke mentioning the first book. Here he's talking about the Gospel of Luke, which is the first book of a two-volume set, with Acts being the second volume. And he's addressing someone with the title Theophilus. Now, there's always a little bit of discussion about who this could be, but generally it's believed that Theophilus, which simply means lover of God or friend of God, is a leader in the Gentile community. He's not a Jew. Clearly, he was also someone that was respected in that community, and most likely, he was a benefactor or a supporter of the Jesus movement. Now, the writer Luke shares that these apostles, though not the original 12, had witnessed Jesus' death, as well as his appearance to them after he was resurrected, and that before he left them through the Holy Spirit, he tells them a couple of other things. First, he orders them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait. But wait for what? Well, they are to wait for the promise of God's Spirit to come to them. that they will be baptized not with water, but with this Holy Spirit. But the thing is, as if they haven't been through enough already, now they have to wait even more. I mean, these guys are still waiting for some political change to come to them, which would free them from the oppressive occupation of the Romans and relief from the corrupt system of religious leaders that they use to keep the common people in check. They've already been waiting and following and listening and witnessing the great deeds of Jesus, and now, after seeing him resurrected and coming into their midst, he leaves them in what has to be a pretty spectacular way, and then he tells them that they have to wait some more. This is what Jesus tells them to do. He tells them to wait. And the thing is, if they would have said, "No, I'm not waiting anymore," and left, they would have revealed their lack of courage as well as their fear of the uncertainty of all of this thing. It would have revealed their lack of faith in him. I mean, if they could not trust the risen Christ who had come into their midst, then just how much faith did they really have? Jesus promises to be with them, to help them. And in the time that they stayed in Jerusalem, they had some time for waiting and to confront their own fears and to measure their own faith. It almost seems like a time of preparation to me. You know, I know that waiting is hard. Waiting is just the worst. And it seems to me, through my own experience as well as witnessing the struggle in others, many of you as well, that this is often a time when we who claim faith can find it to be the most important thing to us. Waiting for a promise to be fulfilled. Waiting for the next thing that you're hoping for. Waiting for the day when you'll be free of debt, or waiting to conceive a child, or waiting for a graduation, or waiting for retirement. Waiting for a diagnosis. Waiting for treatment and its hopeful outcome. Waiting for grief to leave us. Waiting for the promise of God's gift of faith to overcome our fears. Well, like I said, waiting is just so hard. It's one of the hardest things that we can do. And yet we wait and we pray. We wait for God to speak to us in some way and to give us a sign or an answer to our uncertainty. And all of that is hard enough. But now as people, you and I, as people who know the whole story, post-resurrection, we still find ourselves at times having to wait. And why? I mean, certainly this God that we claim and the Christ that's within us knows that we get frustrated or scared and frankly impatient with waiting. I mean, after all, we live in a time when I can press a button on my phone and I can order pretty much whatever I want, and in a day, maybe two, it'll be at my door. I can get on a plane in Houston, and in 3.5 or 4 hours, I can be sitting in my daughter's living room playing with my grandchildren 1,500 miles away. I even find that if I click on a link on my computer, and if it takes more than a second or two to respond, I start wondering if my internet is fast enough. Any wonder why it is that waiting is so hard for us? And the thing is, most of our life is waiting, right? I mean, we spend most of our life in the wilderness, waiting for the next thing, whatever it might be. But when we know that this is true, when we know that waiting is part of our life of faith, when we accept this, when we trust Him enough to let go and let God, we can discover that this time can be a time for us to rearrange our priorities, to slow down, and to listen to God. Jesus gave specific instructions to the disciples before he left them. He told them what to do. They are to wait. He told them where to do it. in Jerusalem. He told them what to wait for, the promise of God's Spirit coming to them. But he didn't tell them how long they would have to wait. He just told them to wait. Our book of faith is filled with God's people waiting for an answer, waiting for prayers, sometimes running away from that waiting. And there are times when we too are told to wait. Maybe you are waiting right now for God to give you an answer that you seek. And listen, when we wait, we pray, but we don't pray for patience. We don't pray for things, for God to add things to us. Instead, we ask God to remove those things that block us off from the sunlight of His Spirit. Instead, we ask God to remove our impatience so that we can live an obedient life of faith that leads us from anxiety and from fear, from choosing our will instead of the assurance of God's will for us. So how do we wait? I don't know. I think the answer is probably obvious and simple. We do what God gives us to do each day. We go to work. We go to school. We clean the house and we prepare our meals and we take care of ourselves and our families. We share the good news of God's good deeds in word and deed. And we do all these things that we do to make a life. And we pray that God reveals His will to us and gives us the power to carry His will out. We live out our faith by trusting and giving over our worry and our impatience to God who sustains us. That is faith. And we pray as often as we need to pray. I happen personally to find the short version of the prayer that Jesus taught us to be most helpful. My will, not my will, but thy will be done. Not my will, but thy will be done. Sisters and brothers, when we live this way, we discover that waiting is no longer a burden that we carry, but a blessing that we hold. So together, we are called to wait upon the Lord. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. As you're able, please stand and we'll continue. Thank you.
stand on it.